Good evening, everyone. Welcome to Learning Recovery Concurrent Session D, where we will be discussing accelerating learning by using out-of-school time programs, specifically comprehensive after-school and summer learning and enrichment programs. I'm Melissa Moritz, and I serve as the After-School and Summer Learning Fellow here at the U.S. Department of Education, and we're thrilled that you could join us as we highlight strong practices from across the nation to utilize ARP ESSER funds to implement high-quality out-of-school time experiences for students who have been disproportionately impacted by the pandemic. We know these experiences help feed students' passions, develop new skills, and connect them to their peers and caring adults. Let's go ahead and dive in. The American Rescue Plan affords historic resources for the field to expand access to high-quality and evidence-based after-school and summer learning. Up to $30.5 billion of ARP funds can be utilized to support out-of-school time across all states. There are $2.4 billion in set-asides that must be used to support after-school and summer learning across the country, and another $28.1 billion of set-asides at the SEA and LEA level that focus on addressing the impacts of lost instructional time that list after school and summer learning as allowable uses. We want to highlight in this conversation examples of strong partnerships at the state and local level, which might occur between different offices at a Department of Education, for example, explicitly involving 21st Century Community Learning Center teams in planning or administration or evaluation of ARP funds, or partnerships between Title I and the offices that are administering ARP funds. Or the partnerships might occur with local community-based organizations or state and local intermediary organizations, such as a statewide after-school network. The conversation today builds on Ed's commitment to out-of-school time. In addition to the 21st Century Community Learning Center program, full-service community schools, and Promise Neighborhoods, the after-school and summer learning field has historic resources provided by the American Rescue Plan to expand access to opportunities these programs provide and ensure that the needs of students and their families, especially those disproportionately impacted by the pandemic, are met. As many of you know, last spring, Ed, in partnership with the National Comprehensive Center and a group of more than 20 national organizations, launched the Summer Learning and Enrichment Collaborative, where we brought together more than 1,300 participants in 8 virtual learning sessions. These recordings, resources, and session materials can still be accessed, and we encourage you to utilize these resources in your work. In addition to the Summer Learning and Enrichment Collaborative resources, the department also hosts the U for Youth website that provides courses and tools to help 21st Century Center Learning Center grantees and their sub-grantees build on their current successes, including a focus on partnerships. Please check those out. Building on the success and interest of the Summer Learning and Enrichment Collaborative, the National Center recently launched a community of practice called the Strategic Use of Summer and After-School Set-Asides Community of Practice. In this community of practice, states are working together in teams to identify, test, and reflect on strategies for using summer learning and after-school funding to benefit youth, families, and out-of-school time systems. The community of practice is currently supporting 6 state teams, and you can follow along with their work by visiting the National Center's website. In addition, some of the national organizations that supported the Summer Learning and Enrichment Collaborative are also providing targeted technical assistance to states, districts, and their partners. We encourage you to access those resources that the department has spotlighted in conjunction with this summit and connect with us and with one another as we continue the work ahead. This work of recovering from the pandemic is hard and unprecedented, but the good news is that we don't have to do it alone. To take us deeper into the theme of partnership, it is my pleasure to introduce our moderator, who is representing the Charles Stewart Mott Foundation, Dr. Terry Peterson. Terry served 8 years as the Chief Education Deputy for a governor and also 8 years as counselor for the United States Secretary of Education, Dick Riley. He helped design innovative education opportunities and partnerships, including after-school and summer programs across America and internationally. He is currently an education consultant to the Mott Foundation and a senior fellow for the Riley Institute at Furman University. He is also the vice chair of the After School Alliance and chairs the National White Riley Peterson After School and Summer Leadership Fellowship. In response to the need to help accelerate learning and expand partnerships to address many COVID learning disruptions, along with Dr. Vandell, he has recently developed the widely used evidence base for comprehensive after school and summer learning enrichment. It is my pleasure to introduce you all to Terry. Terry, take it away.
Thank you, Melissa, and thank the U.S. Department of Education for all your good work and for being involved in this very, very important endeavor. Dramatically increasing and improving comprehensive after-school and summer enrichment opportunities right now really should be your set of strategies if you're working in schools, school districts, or communities. They're really needed to help students to make up for lost learning experiences from the many COVID disruptions. If you are in a school district with schools with 55 or 60% or more students on free or reduced lunch, right now, you have sitting in your district account sufficient American Rescue Plan funds that really by law should be spent over the next 2.5 years to greatly expand and enhance learning opportunities like comprehensive after-school and summer enrichment. They are critical for many of our students to accelerate and improve their learning experiences and expand their horizons in order to catch up, keep up, and thrive. By law, these funds need to be spent on evidence-based strategies. Well-designed and well-delivered comprehensive after-school and summer enrichment have the evidence. Let me review quickly this evidence for you by looking at a few slides. This first slide is a meta-analysis, not an evaluation of a single program. It's an evaluation, really, of 70 after-school programs. 40 of those programs that are well-designed and well-delivered had meaningful percentile gains, as you can see in the chart, from improved attendance, reduction in problem behavior, better school grades, and better test scores. These are really the ABCs of helping students succeed at any time, but particularly now with COVID. Another study that is very important is a longitudinal study. Next slide, please. And in this longitudinal study, what we have here is another way to look at research. So meta-analysis is important, longitudinal studies. What this is looking at what happens to students who participate over time. And this is from grade K through 5. The more students participated, going from left to right, the more they improve, in this case, math achievement. And what is so encouraging here is that the low-income students who are furthest behind improve the most, but so did middle and high income students who participated. This is really, really quite remarkable. But again, these are well-designed, well-delivered programs, but it shows the potential. Next slide, please. In the summer learning arena, a committee of the National Academies of Sciences, Engineering, and Medicine issued a report right before COVID looking at all kinds of research on summertime experiences. And they found for children and youth, again, high quality opportunities in the summer benefits them in academic learning, social emotional development, physical and mental health and safety. Again, this was done right before COVID, but these findings are so, so important. Now, next slide, please. In addition to defining programs that make a difference that have an evidence base, two deans of education, Dr. Deborah Lowe-Vandell and Dr. Pedro Nogueira, identified 5 key principles that are found in well-designed and delivered after-school programs. And this probably is true, too, for summer programs. And that is, learning is active, not passive, not sitting around in after-school and summers. Learning is collaborative. Learning is meaningful. Learning supports mastery, and learning expands horizons. These are sort of some might say, a secret sauce for successful after-school and summer programs. Thank you so much for looking at the slides. Let me mention one quick issue as I finish my opening remarks. I know that staffing shortages can be an issue. So to address this, please consider if you're in education or in community groups, how you can work together. Local community and youth groups with schools, nearby community and four-year colleges, arts, health, and science groups. I know this sounds like more work in developing this partnership, and it might be on the front end to get organized. But in the longer term, these partnerships share the challenges of the recovery with the whole community, pitching in to help. These partnerships will strengthen your school and community support for student success. Students really pick up on when teachers, community groups, paraprofessionals, principals are all working on their behalf and asking them to do their very best, and they will do that. As we finish my opening and Melissa's, you will now hear directly from three examples of successful summer and after-school partnerships. First up, we have a statewide team from South Carolina representing a partnership at the state level. This includes the South Carolina Department of Education and the South Carolina After-School Alliance. As a reminder, every state has a statewide after-school and summer coalition or statewide after-school network like the South Carolina After-School Alliance. Now, to the South Carolina statewide partnership. I'd like each of our panelists to share a little bit about yourselves and your role. Dr. Moore, let's start with you.
Good afternoon. My name is Sabrina Moore. I'm the director of the Office of Student Intervention Services here at the South Carolina Department of Education.
Joyce, what about you?
Hi, I am Joyce Patterson, also with the South Carolina Department of Education, and I am the team leader for the 21st Century Grant.
Zelda?
Hi, it's a pleasure to be here today. I'm Zelda Wehmer, President and CEO of the South Carolina After School Alliance. And the South Carolina After School Alliance is one of 50 statewide networks across the country established to support K-12 students outside of the regular school day.
Michelle?
Good afternoon. I'm Michelle Nimmons, the Director of Grants and Contracts for the South Carolina After School Alliance.
Tell us more about how you are utilizing your ARP ESSER funds to expand access to high quality out of school time, especially for students who have been disproportionately impacted by COVID-19. Dr. Moore and Joyce, please help us out here.
Okay, Joyce, I'll start here just for this broad overview. So with the South Carolina Department of Education, we actually use our ESSER funds in kind of three buckets. We have health and wellness, we have engagement as support, and then extended learning opportunities. And so our partnerships with Zelda and the South Carolina After School Alliance, which Joyce will talk about further, is under that bucket of health and wellness, and then tips over a little bit into engagement and support. And so Joyce, you want to talk about what we do with the After School Alliance and the extended learning?
Absolutely. We have partnered with the After School Alliance. They've been very beneficial to the 21st Century team here and just helping us to, you know, distribute information to their membership. And we were able to offer several professional development webinars. And also with that partnership with the South Carolina After School Alliance, we've also partnered with, the National Dropout Prevention Center, Athletes and Artists, Common Threads, and the South Carolina Department of Office of Early Learning and Literacy, and some, as well as Furman University, which is a partnership between South Carolina Department of Education and the Raleigh Institute, where they are kind of grooming after-school leaders to be, you know, even stronger in the after-school and out-of-time funding. And so also we were able to offer a few of these webinars addressing learning loss, learn, explore, and grow, recipes for success, go pro in the skills of reading, and strategies for motivating and engaging learners in literacy and math instruction beyond the school day. That was a mouthful, but these are some of the things that we've been able to provide to 21st Century subgrantees, as well as the membership through the After School Alliance. And with that, we were also able to just provide, you know, training and resources, you know, to those that attended. So we were hoping that, you know, after each webinar, they will have some takeaways that they could immediately go back to their centers and begin implementing. So those are just a few of the things that we've been doing in conjunction with the After School Alliance.
Zelda, tell us a little bit about the story of your partnership, how you started working together, how did you decide who held what roles, and how it has evolved through the pandemic.
The South Carolina After School Alliance turns 20 years old this year, and so does our partnership. The South Carolina Department of Education is a founding member of the network. And when the Mott Foundation decided to establish the networks, the South Carolina Department of Education was one of the first to invest and recognize the important role of after-school and summer programs and what they play in the lives of children and youth. As the State Department prepared to manage and coordinate 21st century community learning centers, we were preparing to identify programs across the state, provide professional development and technical assistance to enhance quality services and support the advancement of policies that strengthen programming. Today, we continue to support 21st century community learning centers and a network of over 1,400 community-based programs serving over 100,000 kindergarten through 12th grade students. When the South Carolina Department of, well, when the U.S. Department of Education identified after school and summer as a strategy to accelerate learning through ESSER and the American Rescue Plan, Superintendent Molly Spearman knew how she could reach students impacted the most by COVID-19. And with an understanding of our network and our network's reach, we worked with the superintendent to develop a plan to identify and fund evidence-based programs in underserved areas to address the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 on certain groups of students attending after-school and summer programs.
And so I'll just kind of compliment Zelda on the fact that we have been in this partnership for 20 years. And to say, too, that we recognize at the department that if we're going to maximize our reach, if we are really going to impact students all across the state, we can't do that alone. We need partners. And I know that that's why the value of the After School Alliance is so critically important. And so we have been able to connect with other community and faith-based organizations. One thing we applaud is that I believe the After School Alliance helps other programs, nonprofits, to prepare to become 21st century community learning centers programs as a grant-funded program. So we cannot understate that the importance of that assistance from the Alliance.
What have you been able to do together that you wouldn't have been able to do alone?
So for the Department of Education, I think as what we were saying, added capacity. You know, we don't have the arms to reach all of the nonprofits, what we call the small moms and pops. We don't have that capacity within the department. So we need an organization like the After School Alliance to expand that capacity. We know that all the children who need after school assistance, they're not all in schools. So they need a place in their communities to go. And so adding that capacity, and then just knowing that we have another organization that's going to celebrate evidence-based and best practices. So we are confident that the information that we're sharing is consistent with the information that's being shared by the After School Alliance. So at the close of the day, we're all winners.
Zelda, what would you add?
Well, our relationship with the Department of Education definitely adds credibility to our work. It gets us an audience with school leaders and educators who might not otherwise know our work and our resources. And of course, it brings financial resources. In our first year of implementation, we're able to start and expand financial support to 45 community organizations across 26 school districts, implementing 35 after-school programs and 43 summer programs, and provide support to 4,400 K-12 students outside of the regular school day.
Joyce, how about sharing with us some of the resources that you've learned about that working together can maximize?
Well, I'm really kind of piggybacking on really on what Dr. Moore stated, and as well as Zelda. I'm really kind of new to the partnership with the After School Alliance, but I can just tell you that in the short time I've been working with them, that it forges a stronger relationship between, you know, the After School Alliance and I'll just say my 21st century portion. We just couldn't have done the work that we've done already without the support of the After School Alliance.
Michelle, you've really got a unique role here that can be really helpful to folks tuning in from either the state, school district, or community level. You've recently transitioned from a district, and now you work in the Alliance, and you're working with ARP money, connecting those funds to community-based groups and schools. Tell us what you've been able to do together and what you've learned.
Well, this partnership has reinforced for me what I've always known is that resources that can go into rural communities, which I spent over 40 years working in rural school districts, where I saw firsthand the need for after-school programming. Rural school districts don't have the monies to support after-school, or communities don't have money to build after-school programming for young people, and they rely on school districts to do those kinds of things. And it's generally around athletics when it's a small rural school district, and everybody doesn't play with the ball. So these funds are going to impact some young person's life in a way that we can't even begin to imagine. It's going to open up a brand new world for them. And I'm excited about the partnership and the work that I get to be a part of. It's always been my passion to work with young people or for young people. And this connection with the Alliance and the partnership with the Department of Ed lets me continue to do that.
As we begin wrapping up, each of you, what advice do you have for states or school districts or nonprofits who are interested in partnering but aren't quite sure where to start or how to take it to a next level? Dr. Moore.
Whether it's a state or a school district or nonprofit, I would say first, start with your organization and your purpose. Like, what are you supposed to be doing? So make sure that whatever partnership you're looking at is going to amplify your mission and your purpose. Seek out organizations that have similar purposes. You know, if it's about after school, then about after school. Work together by looking at each other's strengths and your weaknesses. We can't be all things to all people. So we look at the strengths of your organization as your kind of gap analysis, and then decide what do I need assistance with? And then seek out organizations, credible organizations that can help you fill in those gaps. And then I think if you put that formula together, you will be well on your way to an effective partnership that benefits you, your partners, and the students they serve.
Zelda?
I think partnerships are at the heart of this work. It may take longer initially, but the partnerships at the state and local levels are essential to get this work right for the kids and families impacted the most by the pandemic. It's worth investing time on the front end to make sure that all young people get the quality after school and summer experiences they deserve. There is a statewide after school network in every state that is eager to work with the State Department of Education to help make this historic opportunity a success and to provide resources and support to local districts and community partners who are working to implement after school and summer programs.
Joyce, what would you like to add?
Well, very briefly, partnerships is key. It's hard for, as Sabrina has said, and both wellness, so I'm really kind of piggybacking again off what they've already stated, but the importance of partnership building is key. And for my 21st Century Community Learning Centers grantees and potential grantees, you know, even the partnership within the After School Alliance can potentially open up, you know, an area where they can apply for my grants. And then we can, it's just, you know, kind of hand in hand. So the partnership is there. And so any advice that I would give to another state, you know, seek out your local, you know, after school alliance type organization, and then just kind of go from there, because the strength of partnerships is what's key.
Michelle, again, you sort of have a unique role in that you just came from working with school districts. Now you're helping the After School Alliance and the Department of Education run a competitive ARP grant program for community-based groups. What do you tell nonprofits you're working with and how to reach out to schools, or how do you suggest schools work with nonprofits?
I think first, let me say they need to tap into the network, join so that they have an opportunity to access all of our resources. Go to your school district, your local school district, and seek out the 21st century director or the director of instruction who knows what they're doing after school. Talk. Be open to listening and partnering. This is going to be an amazing opportunity for young people in communities all across this state. And I'm just excited about what young people will have access to. Quality programming means the world to a community with small resources, because young people will get the benefit of knowledge and experiences that they wouldn't otherwise have. And I'm elated to be a part of this initiative and see young people maximize their potential in South Carolina.
Thank you, South Carolina team.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Next up, we have a fantastic local team from Tulsa, Oklahoma. Paula and Caroline, please share a little bit about yourselves and your roles.
Sure thing, Terry. We're excited to be here. My name is Paula Shannon. I am the Deputy Superintendent for Tulsa Public Schools in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We serve 35,000 learners in grades pre-K through 12. And we are very excited to share our story about how we partner with our community to provide learners opportunities in the summer and after school.
Thank you so much, Terry, for having us. We're thrilled to be here and share the Tulsa story. My name is Caroline Shaw, and I am the Executive Director of the Opportunity Project, which is the out-of-school time intermediary in Tulsa. We work with almost 100 community-based organizations and partners that serve young people outside school buildings.
Tell us more about how you are using ARP ESSER funds to expand access the quality after school and summer opportunities in the out of time space, especially for students who really need it the most.
So I can take the beginning of that, and then I'll pass over to Caroline. We have a rich history, recent history that we're building upon. And so the ESSER dollars came just at the right time to help us expand. We launched in Tulsa, the Opportunity Project, which is our out-of-school time intermediary, about 5 years ago, through generous investments with the Wallace Foundation and local philanthropy. We had like a very small set of out-of-school time experiences happening, predominantly funded through 21st century grants to some of our community-based organizations. And through the Wallace Initiative, we began to really look at how to integrate social-emotional learning into both the school day and out-of-school time space through programming we had on our own called our after-learning programs, as well as those 21st century programs. So we learned a lot during those early years. And a teacher walkout in 2018 helped us to really leverage some of that early partnership and infrastructure and helped us understand what it means to really start working as an ecosystem. So as the pandemic hit, that rich infrastructure and ecosystem was in place to help provide opportunities to engage our young people. And that then expanded into the summer opportunities that we launched last summer, in summer of 2021. We're investing ARP dollars heavily to fund this. So we have a contract with the Opportunity Project in which we pass dollars to support our local organizations. And we also are investing about 10 to 12 million a summer, last summer, this summer, upcoming summer, in a 4-week set of summer learning camps for our students. That goes to funding staff, our staff, that goes to funding the Opportunity Project and those local organizations that partner with us, supports transportation, as that's a key factor. It helps on the child nutrition side. So those dollars are really maximizing, providing more learning opportunities for our kiddos, particularly who need it most.
Absolutely, Paula. And really, this has been a wonderful opportunity for us to build on the infrastructure. As Paula mentioned, that we have been working on for the past 5 to 6 years. So we are happy to be a representative, an arm of our K-12 partners to really coalesce around high quality out of school time programming and how we're supporting partners in both delivering that programming, but also being very intentional about how we are scaling that out across our community with an explicit focus on equity and making certain that opportunities are available to learners all across the district. So we are really looking forward this summer to building on the experiments and sort of the innovation that took place in summer 2021 to be able to reach even more young people with these really rich learning opportunities, hands-on experiences, adults who are connected to them, and really can help build and drive that engagement for young people across the summer and into the fall, into the school year. So we are not only partnering with the district in their very intensive 4-week full-day experience for young people, but also working with community partners to bridge when school lets out in May all the way through to when school comes back in session in August. So really trying to be that bridge and fill in those gaps so that families and young people have safe and fun, really, most importantly, fun places to go over the summer.
And say, Terry, last summer we served a little over 10,000 learners. And that was a huge shift for us because in previous summers, we had centralized summer school across maybe 8 sites. Wow. We have about 75 school sites. We served close to 3,000 students. And so the call to action that Dr. Gist, our superintendent, and I set for our school leaders is that we were going to offer summer camp, not summer school, but summer camp at every single site that Tulsa Public Schools had. And that was an enormous undertaking and shift. My colleagues give me a hard time in a loving way because I literally almost broke the system last summer. But it was quite transformative. We had, like I said, over 10,000 learners that participated. We saw gains in the students who participated in the fall in their NWEA MAP reading proficiency rates. So we saw a 3 percentage point increase for students who participated versus those who did not. And we saw a small bump in math of 1 percentage point. Given that most of those 10,000 learners were actually pretty significantly below grade level in their reading and math proficiency, they were starting at a much lower place than many of the students that did not participate. That was a sizable accomplishment, and we were very proud of that. And we're confident that we're going to see even greater gains this summer with the improvements that we're making.
Very exciting. I like your combination of both the schools involved and then it's sort of in between time, the community-based organizations. What a great, powerful combination. And I can see why you've got positive results. And people need to remember that there's a lot of earlier studies that would indicate in the summers, if there are no experiences, young people actually lose ground. So you didn't lose ground. You didn't even stay even. You made up ground, and that is really important. So tell us about, given that, how did your partnership start? How do you divide up your roles, and how does all this evolve through the pandemic?
Paula, I'll let you start to kick that off.
Yeah, that's what's really important to note is that we in Tulsa Public Schools, we believe it takes all of us, right? We believe that the work we do is not just about education, it's about youth development. So we take that approach, and we believe that we have to have shared responsibility for the development of our young learners with everyone in our community. And I think like one of the things that has been helpful is that the Opportunity Project team members of the Tulsa Public Schools team have really co-created the model that we're using. We believe in learning science, right? We really value that learning happens anytime, anywhere, that it is social, emotional, and cognitive. And we had a shared commitment that particularly last summer, we weren't going to lead with, we have to tackle unfinished learning and we have to like double down on interventions and focus just on the cognitive side of the work. While that's important, we led with fun, we led with relationships and a deep belief that if you're not tending to the social and emotional side of learning, then the cognitive part's not going to happen. So we really ground in four components of our design. One is that we're going to like build bolder programming together. Again, shared responsibility that involves like all of our community-based youth-serving organizations, right? Like they have lots to teach us as traditional educators, and we have things that we can share with community-based educators. We wanted to ensure broader high-quality learning. So the ARP spends a lot of time helping us understand what quality means, how you measure it, and putting those tools into place. We really want to cultivate community and belonging. So creating connectedness and really focusing on those relationships is important. And then we know that it requires an organizing entity like the Opportunity Project. So we are making sizable investments as a community, not just a district, but as a community in investing in that backbone support for sustainability. So that's really like how we ground. And I think we just have a shared belief that this work is the work of equity, right? That none of us own the table, but we have to help create this shared table. I often say that it's our job in positions of privilege to put more seats at that table and help make that table bigger so that we're doing the work together in partnership and allyship with the community-based educators who are closest to our students.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's a critical component. And one of the things, if we're, Terry, to your question about division of labor in this endeavor, I think one of the things that we are both strongly rooted in is the belief that it starts with the adults. And we have a strong commitment to making sure that we are both giving adults the tools they need to be very engaged with young people, but also to take care of themselves. So that's a key function that we want to help support across the youth development spectrum. We do a lot of training, as Paula mentioned, and support a considerable amount of that professional development leading up to summer, which is a huge win for us. It's one of those things that really gets us excited and helps us understand our role and how far we've come in our relationship with the district and the larger community, is that we are really not only invited in, but allowed to lead a lot of the training that leads up to summer programming. So we can focus on the things that Paula mentioned around engagement, connection, rich learning experiences, those kinds of things that maybe not in the everyday training repertoire that a K-12 classroom teacher may have in the regular course of business. So that's one way that we support. Another way is we actually developed and underwrite the cost of a citywide data system for all of our OST out-of-school time partners to use. The system is tied into the school district's system that allows us to pull over information about young people that helps us serve them in a more robust and intentional way. And that is available to all of our community partners to use at no cost to them. And it is also a requirement of the summer programming that we engage in. So we have an opportunity to be able to understand impact and, again, to, the focus on equity, to understand where we may be falling short. So that's a very critical component of what we do. And then I think Paul also referenced the quality piece. So working on not only delivering high quality programming, but understanding, again, where that's happening really well, and we can lift up examples of that and where we might be able to see areas of opportunity for growth, where we can get even better and serve even more young people.
Very quickly, what can you think of maybe one thing in each of your sectors that you probably couldn't have done well or at all if you hadn't had your partnership?
I would say it's the like reframing of the work around youth development and the investment that we're making in helping all of the adults who are working with our youth ground in positive youth development strategies. That wouldn't be happening without our partnership.
Absolutely. And I know that we would not have the opportunity to reach so many young people without the cooperation and the support and allyship of the school district. It has been critical to the ability for us to be able to give partners the space to scale out and serve more young people. So it's one of those things that is absolutely foundational for our work.
Very quickly, what advice would you have for states or school districts or nonprofits who are interested in partnering in after school and summers, but aren't quite sure how to start? What is the key one or two things in a way to start?
Start small. And like, I'll speak from a school district perspective. All of you have those school leaders and teachers who desire to be really innovative. Now is the time to do that. So start small with those schools and get them connected with local partners. If you don't have an intermediary, like as a school district, you can become like a small one in the very beginning to just create the container for people to work together. And like be different, right? Like move beyond the confines of the traditional day and the like, you know, conversation that is just framed around unfinished learning and shift your conversation to one about youth development.
I love all of those suggestions. I would say be bold, number one, and don't be afraid to innovate. And two, really make sure you're taking into consideration all adults and all spaces. There are assets within a school community that can be leveraged during the summer months that might not be during a school year or might serve a different role during a school year. So really look to all adults in your community and think of them as youth development workers. That's what we really need, is we need all adults to be focused on positive youth development.
Thank you so much for sharing your very important work in Tulsa. It's a terrific example for all of us to learn from. Appreciate what you're doing, and let's move on to our next segment.
Next up is the team from Stamford, Connecticut. Amy, Edith, and Lauren, please share a little bit about yourselves and your roles.
Hi, I'm Amy Veldotti. I'm the Associate Superintendent for Teaching and Learning here in the Stamford Public Schools. My job encompasses curriculum, instruction, and assessment for all of our 21 schools and two additional programs, preschool and our alternative high school.
Hi, my name is Edith Presley. I'm the president of Stamford Cradle to Career. Happy to serve in this role with my past experience in community advocacy and formalized educational leadership. I also am blessed enough to be a graduate of Stamford Public School and a parent of two students currently in our school district. That really allows me to focus my lens depending on our work and lets me know how important collective impact is for our community.
Good evening. I'm Lauren Scopez-Donay, Vice President at Stamford Cradle to Career. In my role, I oversee the work of our community action networks, which are groups of stakeholders brought together to focus on three areas of our work: early childhood, ensuring children are ready for kindergarten, early grade reading, ensuring children are reading proficiently by third grade, and finally, college and career readiness, ensuring our students are graduating prepared for the future. And I've done this work for the past 3 years after spending almost 12 years at Harlem Children's Zone in New York City. I also have children in the district, and I'm a resident here in Stamford. Happy to support my local community through my work.
Now, please tell us about how you're using the American Rescue Plan ESSER funds for expanded access to quality after school and summer opportunities in the out of school time space, especially for students impacted by the pandemic.
So I'll begin by just sharing what we've done throughout the school year this year in terms of after school and Saturday programming. We've been using our ESSER funds to provide high quality after school programs and Saturday programs targeted around what we call acceleration and recovery academies. So we are identifying students who were disproportionately impacted by the pandemic, both in terms of academics, but also in terms of social emotional need. And so we've had an opportunity to run three sessions of really robust after-school programming for our students that are taught by our Stamford Public Schools teachers. So those programs happen in each of our elementary schools and our middle schools. At the high school level, we've done something a little bit different. We've offered credit recovery programming during the school day by creatively scheduling students to receive opportunities to attend academic labs in our high schools and again, receive support from certified teachers in a variety of content areas. And that has also been a really wonderful program to be able to launch this year using ESSER funds.
And in our program, we've been able to really support the work that Amy just talked about and the different community action networks that Lauren previewed. But particularly in the summertime, we focused on our summer enrichment program, and we help support students after the academic block of summer school with really enriching activities from community-based vendors. This has given us the opportunity to diversify the vendors that we service and that are able to be contracted to work with our kids. We were deliberate. We're looking for women-owned businesses and minority-owned businesses in this work, just so that our children can be immersed in activities that may be new to them while being socially responsible through an equity lens in our community. We're also very happy to host the Stamford Summer Literacy Initiative, in which Stamford Public Schools and the Ferguson Library are our foremost partners. In this effort, we partner with community-based camps to push in literacy support, intervention, and really providing a literacy-rich environment so that extra work in summer or after school doesn't feel stigmatizing. It's just embedded in the program and what happens because we know it's what's best for kids.
Tell us a little bit about your partnership on the ground. For example, how did you start working together? How do you divide up your roles? And how has it evolved throughout the pandemic?
Thank you for that question, Terry. So Stamford Cradle to Career is a collective impact initiative based on the National Strive Together model. And in the beginning conversations, when Stamford started thinking about, should we start this collective impact model, Stamford Public Schools was a key stakeholder at the table in the planning process to decide how and if and when we should do this collective impact work, agreeing to follow a common agenda and have a common mission for our work across the different sectors within the city, obviously including the public schools, our nonprofit and community organizations, the city, our family stakeholders, and the local business community. And there are a couple ways that we worked in to ensure that structure and that partnership between the district and our community organizations happen throughout. So in our leadership structure, our executive team, which is our board, has a seat reserved for someone that the superintendent identifies from her cabinet, from the district. It has a seat for a member of the Board of Education. Additionally, in our community action network groups, we have a leadership role reserved for a member of Stamford Public Schools, whether it's a principal or a director of curriculum instruction or director of early childhood work, as well as other members, depending on their role, involved in our planning and implementation throughout. So we are really embedded at all levels of the partnership and all levels of the district and our organization to ensure there is complete alignment across the work that we're doing.
Maybe very quickly, each of you, could you reflect on what have you been able to do together that you wouldn't have been able to do alone?
I think as Lauren referenced, our power is our partnership. We're able to very comprehensively examine programs and offerings through the lens of our community partners, some of which are direct service organizations, some that support social emotional support and development. And through our continuum of work, really focusing on students from cradle to career, we're able to developmentally look at what we're offering to see what the student should or could have had prior to that offering so that they're most ready, and we can differentiate that program, and also being mindful of what we can and should do with our time with them so they're most prepared for their next step. So really just analyzing the developmental tracks of students so that we can provide support. Also looking at just the earnest needs of families. We were coming out of the pandemic, particularly last summer, things were opening up. Our traditional academic program offered about 4 hours a day. Last year, 5 hours a day. We were able to expand our offering to do full day childcare in very enriching ways so that families could work and students could grow.
And I'll give just one other specific example. Amy on our call here is a co-leader of our early grade reading can, and a critical role that she has played in her staff is providing professional development around the strategies, tools, and curriculum that the school is using for promoting early literacy. And we, as the collaborator at Cradle to Career, convene multiple community partners, including smaller organizations who wouldn't have the time or staff or relationships to connect with the district to bring that alignment of learning so that what's happening in out of school time can be completely aligned with and supported by what the district is doing.
Yeah, and I think for the Stamford Public Schools, I mean, it's been a wonderful partnership with Cradle to Career. We are, you know, we consider ourselves the education experts with, you know, just a wealth of knowledge here in our own district from the paraeducator, teacher level, administrative level. But our partnership with Cradle to Career, as Lauren mentioned, is really they're able to bring the right partners to the table so that we can share what is happening inside our classrooms and really support what's happening in our after-school programs across the city. And then, of course, what's happening in the summertime across our camps and all of our wonderful programs that we have here in Stamford. So it's a partnership that we greatly value in their ability to bring stakeholders to the table that sometimes are a little bit elusive for the public schools to find.
I love that term, elusive. You've really cracked some of the nuts in terms of partnerships. And that's really what our final question is. And kind of looking to the future and looking outside of your windows, what advice do you have for states or school districts or nonprofits who are interested in partnering but aren't quite sure where to start and what to do next? Could each of you maybe suggest one or two starting points?
I would start by getting everyone to the table. That's how we started here in Stamford. Really identifying those people that are really focused on making your community better, because no one agency can do it alone. It cannot just be the Stamford or the public schools or private schools or the city or, you know, a particular camp or library. It really has to be all people in your community that are interested in improving the lives of children. And that is truly our commitment here in Stamford, from cradle to career. And so it's wonderful to partner with, you know, all of the partners that Lauren mentioned earlier. So that would be my advice. Get started by getting everyone to the table and start figuring out your vision for what you want your community to be.
I appreciate that you said vision, because I think that's really what this type of work takes. Really answering an earnest question and thinking outside of the box, taking the expertise and the past lessons, but also the innovation that this time has brought us. The COVID pandemic was awful in so many ways. However, it did present us with many opportunities. So really coming to the table and looking on what new learning we can capitalize off of while still answering earnest questions around academic remediation, time out of school, and need for nurturing and supportive structures.
And just two quick suggestions from my perspective. The first, as I mentioned earlier a little bit, but it is to get the people on the ground at the implementation level from the district, as well as from community organizations, talking together and planning together. Because it is amazing what happens when you have experts from different perspectives come together and coming up with great solutions and accessing opportunities that would be hard to tackle on their own. And the second area is around family engagement and youth engagement. Often our community organizations have close ties. They're working with smaller groups of families and students and really leveraging what the district is doing and opening those communication channels through our community partners and through partnerships really allows both our organizations to benefit by knowing what's happening at the district and being able to support parents through that, as well as allowing the district to have deeper access to students and families through their community organizations where there are trusted relationships.
Thank you so much for the important work you're doing in Connecticut and the example you're setting for many places around the country. We really appreciate what we've learned from you. Now let me turn this over to Melissa at our U.S. Department of Education. Melissa.
Wow. Thank you so much to our panelists for their work and for taking time to share their expertise with us. As you know, they are incredibly busy, and I am so grateful that they were able to join us to share how the resources afforded by the American Rescue Plan have impacted their work and their communities, and to share more about how they are utilizing these resources to support partnerships within their offices and with community-based organizations to reach more students, engage families, and support their local communities. A huge thank you to Terry for facilitating such an insightful conversation, and thank you to each and every one of you too. This is a huge moment and opportunity for us. We have the opportunity to provide our students and their families with learning experiences that not only support with recovery from the pandemic, but support reimagining learning for young people with engaging, enriching experiences that support their social, emotional, and academic outcomes, both in and out of school. As I said at the top, this work is hard, but we are not alone. Please don't hesitate to reach out to us at ED, any of the panelists who are joining us this evening, or any of the technical assistance providers we mentioned on the call. It would be our pleasure to support you and your work and your local communities. Have a great evening, and thank you so much for joining.